Hello, I am Dada Patil. Let us see a topic, imparting an enhanced Bloom's learning level to undergraduate civil engineering learners through solving the application oriented problem of pure bending theory in strength of materials course. So let us begin. Now let us see what is Bloom's taxonomy of various learning levels. There are six levels, that is knowledge, comprehension, application, analysis, synthesis and evaluation. Many times what happens is students or learners rather, they remain to the level of knowledge or comprehension. They seldom go to the application or the levels above application. So what a teacher can do is take the problems in the class in such a way that automatically the students are compelled to learn how to apply the knowledge to a new situation. So here if you see the first level of Bloom, that is L1, is knowledge, which is nothing but the recall of information, where students can describe, name, recite, recognize, list, match, relate, repeat, reproduce, state, etc. Whereas learning level 2, L2, is comprehension, where it is nothing but the translation or interpretation or extrapolation of knowledge, where the learners can arrange, explain, interpret, classify, express, locate, describe, identify, report, discuss, indicate, restate, sort, translate, extrapolate, etc. Whereas the third level, which is application, that is application of knowledge to a new situation, where the learners can solve, demonstrate, apply, construct, predict, prepare, produce, sketch, solve, use, write, etc. So the problems which we take in civil engineering can be taken in such a way that students would be imparted how to apply it in practical situation. So here I have made an attempt to solve one problem from Mechanics of Materials book written by James Gear. It's an unsolved problem given in the book in pure bending theory. This is a practical oriented problem which takes the students to enhance Bloom's learning level. So let us start. A small balcony constructed of wood here is supported by three identical cantilever beams. That is, here this is one beam, this is one more beam, and the third beam. It is cantilever, there is free at one end and fixed at the other end. Each beam has length L1 is equal to 2.1 meter. So this length is 2.1 meter. Width B and height is H. So here the width of the beam is B, where height H is 4/3 of B. The dimensions of the balcony floor are L1 into L2, with L2 is equal to 2.5 meter. So this overall area is obviously L1 into L2. Already we know L1 is 2.1 meter and L2, this length is given as 2.5 meter. The design load on the balcony is 5.5 kilopascal or kilonewton per meter square acting over the entire floor area. This load accounts for all loads except the weights of the cantilever beams, that means self weight, which have a weight density gamma equal to 5.5 kilonewton per meter cube. The allowable bending stress in the cantilever is 15 megapascal. That is, the maximum bending stress which is allowed in this wood material is 15 newton per mm square. Assuming that the middle cantilever supports 50% of the total load and each outer cantilever supports 25% of the load, determine the required dimensions B and H. So we have to solve this problem with the condition that the middle cantilever supports 50% of the total load, whereas the outer two cantilever support 25% of the total load. We have to determine the dimensions of B and H. So let us start. We know that L1 given is 2.1 meter and L2 is 2.5 meter. Therefore, the plan area of the balcony is A equal to L1 into L2, that is 2.1 into 2.5, that is 5.25 meter square. The imposed load or the live load on the balcony is given as 5.5 kN per meter square, and therefore the total load intensity is that load 5.5 into the area of the balcony 5.25. Therefore it is 28.875 kN. there is a total load acting on this area of the balcony is 28.875 kilonewton. It is already given that middle cantilever, this one supports half of the load, that is 50% of the load, and therefore the imposed load or the live load carried by middle cantilever is 28.875 divided by 2, that is 14.4375 kilonewton. But we are not interested in the total load intensity, we are interested in the uniformly distributed load carried by the middle cantilever. Therefore, the imposed uniformly distributed load on the middle cantilever is obviously that total load carried by middle cantilever divided by the length L1. Therefore, it is 14.4375 divided by 2.1, which works out to be 6.875 kilonewton per meter. Therefore, this middle cantilever is carrying a uniformly distributed load of 6.875 kilonewton per meter. Again, the self weight of the middle cantilever, we know that it is volume into unit weight of the material. So, volume into gamma. Now, what is volume? Volume is B into H into length L1, and unit weight of material is given as 5.5 kilonewton per meter cube. And therefore, the self weight works out to B into H is 4B by 3 into 2.1 into 5.5, which works out to be 15.4 B square. It is in kilonewton, because here 5.5 is in kilonewton per meter cube, whereas here it is meter into meter into meter, that is meter cube. So the total self weight of the middle cantilever is 15.4 B square in kilonewton. But we want again UDL, therefore UDL due to self weight or own weight is 15.4 B square divided by the length L1, that is 2.1. So it works out to be 7.33 B square kilonewton per meter. This precisely means that the uniformly distributed load created by the self weight of the middle cantilever is 7.33 B square kilonewton per meter. And therefore the total UDL Q is nothing but imposed load or imposed UDL plus self weight UDL for middle cantilever, that is 6.875 plus 7.33 B square kilonewton per meter. Now going further, we know that the maximum bending moment is will be at the fixed end B, and it is given as Q into this L1 that I have converted an imaginary point load, and it acts at L1 by 2 from B. Therefore, it is Q into L1 into L1 by 2. There is a hogging bending moment of Q L1 square by 2, which is written here. Now we know the value of Q. This is the value of Q into L1 is 2.1 into 2.1 by 2. And therefore, bending moment works out to be 2.205 into 6.875 plus 7.33 B square. Now, the area moment of inertia, that is second moment of area of a rectangle, is given by I equal to BH cube by 12. It is B by 12 into 64 into B cube by 27, because H is 4B by 3. That works out to be 0.1975 B raised to 4. Y is nothing but, if this is a neutral axis, then it is a distance of extreme fiber from the neutral axis, so it is H by 2. Therefore, it is 0.67 B. Sigma, it is given in the problem that the maximum bending stress which wooden material should experience is 15 Newton per mm square, or 15 into 10 to 3 kilonewton per meter square. Now we know that equation of pure bending theory is M by I equal to sigma by Y equal to E by R, where M is moment of resistance of the section or bending moment measured in kilonewton meter, I is area moment of inertia of the section, is meter raised to 4, sigma is bending stress in a layer at a distance Y from neutral axis measured in kilonewton per meter square, Y is distance of the layer under consideration from neutral axis in meter, E is Young's modulus of the material, here it is wood, it is kilonewton per meter square, and finally R is radius of curvature of the bent beam in meter. So here we know that as the cantilever bends, there will be tension at the top and compression at the bottom. Therefore, here it shows the stress distribution diagram where above the neutral axis the fibers are subjected to tension, and below the neutral axis they are subjected to compression. substituting the values into m by I equal to sigma by y, because we really don't know what is radius of curvature and Young's modulus. Therefore, using the first two terms of the equation, when we substitute, we result into b equal to 0.152 meter, that is 152 mm. Therefore, h is 4b by 3. It is given in the problem itself that height has to be taken as 1/4 of width of the beam, and therefore it is 202.67 mm. Therefore, the middle cantilever must have a rectangular cross section with the width of 152 mm and depth of around 203 mm. It is 202.67 mm, so we round it off, so it is 203 mm. Similarly, it is given that each outer cantilever supports 25% of the load. So we can go on the similar line now. So imposed load carried by outer cantilever will be the total load divided by 4, because if you remember correctly, the total load was 28.875 kN, and each outer cantilever is carrying 25%, so it is divided by 4, so it is 7.21875 kN. The imposed radial on outer cantilever will be obviously that 7.21875 kN divided by the length of the outer cantilever, that is L1 again, which is 3.4375 kN per meter. Now already we calculated UDL due to self weight as 7.33 b square kN per meter in the case of middle cantilever. The same applies here. So total UDL Q will be imposed UDL plus self weight UDL for outer cantilever, that is 3.4375 plus 7.33 b square. Again, the maximum bending moment will be at the fixed end B, that is Q into L1 into L1 by 2. So it is M equal to 2.205 into 3.4375 plus 7.33 b square. Area moment of inertia, already we calculated 0.1975 b raised to 4, y already we know 0.67b, sigma also already we know it is 15 into 10 to 3 kN per meter square, and therefore again when we use m by I equal to sigma by y, we get b is equal to 0.120 meter, that is 120 mm, and therefore we get h equal to 4/3b, that is 160 mm, and therefore the outer cantilever, that is two outer cantilevers, must have a rectangular cross section with width b equal to 120 mm and depth h equal to 160 mm, and therefore we can conclude that middle cantilever should have dimensions of this middle cantilever 152 mm into 203 mm, whereas these two outer cantilevers have dimensions of 120 mm into 160 mm. So the application of the famous pure bending formula in strength of materials, m by I equal to sigma by y equal to e by r, can be demonstrated to the learner through such simple application oriented problems. We can demonstrate the same problem by just solving a simple problem in the class, but making students understand how it can be practically applicable by taking such unsolved problems from some good books available in the subject of strength of materials will definitely boost the confidence of learners, and thereby they will understand why to learn such concepts and where to apply such concepts exactly. So thank you very much.